Hey, born and raised, talking about magic day after day. Chilling out, drafting, recorded a show, and the guy on the left...
Wait, where did he go?
Made a few episodes, then he moved to L.A. Tristan and his jerseys saved the day. Cranking out top eights, Web lends a hand.
They're better than a show about the cost of land.
Throwing cards at Tristan and he gets mad. Props to sidekicks Patrick, Conley, and Brad. Talk to LSV if you want to play blue.
Talk to TSG if you're a noob.
If you watched every week as Humphrey died,
with Tristan in charge, it ain't no surprise.
Another tree would be a gruesome encore. Here's to Magic TV, show us 100 more.
Hey everyone, welcome to a very special Magic TV... I mean, it's 100th episode, so we've got everything. We're doused in white. We've got our original host, the guy on the left.
On the right.
Scanlon. Now on the right.
On the right, but on the left.
He's on the right side.
I mean, I don't want to start things on a downer note.
But if you notice, our longtime companion Humphrey is no longer here.
Yeah.
This is what happens when I leave town. You guys murder the other co-host.
We have it on film, Sean committing to taking
care
of Humphrey.
It's true. I didn't so much upgrade as we've kind of changed. I'd like to introduce everyone to the public, not only with the loving memory of Humphrey gone, but everyone to Darksteel Humphrey.
Yeah.
He's very indestructible.
Yeah, and he came with some companions.
Yeah.
They don't get names, though, because...
We're kind of between two plants now, which is our other kind of side gig.
You know, guys, my sorrow on this is genuine. You guys are totally just dialing it in. Okay. I walk in here, Humphrey's gone. He's dead.
Look, I tried. I don't think Sean did.
Tried? We had him on life support. I had people watching him 24/7. Yeah. He was bedridden.
The fact of the matter is, regardless of the level of incompetence in Sean's care, this Humphrey is never dying.
It's true. It's true.
I defy you to prove that. We'll be back for 200.
Yeah.
A smoldering pile of ashes.
Yeah.
It's not, he might get abused, but not by us. Not by us.
So I guess, yeah, consider that a good intro now that we've explained the new Humphrey and his situation here.
We've got so many sweet topics, so many things to cover. Anything you guys want to start with particularly, or should I just continue to lead this?
Kick us off.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we're here 100 episodes deep into Magic TV, but that's not really what's as exciting as Team Fireball, the website, everything that's kind of happened. I mean, again, I want to stop. Let's thank everybody that's ever watched this.
Absolutely.
Pants or no pants.
we definitely have to thank all our viewers. Without you guys, then we wouldn't be here filming 100th episode, and I would never have met Sean. So why am I thanking? No. No, but our viewers, our contributors, our writers. We have writers who, alongside myself, have been here since the beginning of the website. David Ochoa is one of them. Josh Utter-Layton, currently writing his Pro Tour second place report, an intermittent writer at this point, but when the website started, he was one of our more prolific writers. Zane Begg, who's now taken more of the management role, but he was one of the authors that started us. Josh Silvestri, and all our other writers. I mean, we have a ton of writers, and I'm not going to thank all of them, but they're all a part of it.
Well, one of the great things to really point out, too, is the fact that when things started, we all knew Raptor and Ocho were great players, but they hadn't hit the scene yet.
Yeah.
And it was really kind of the genesis of Team Fireball, the rise of Channel Fireball, and these guys who we're all friends with coming together. And all of a sudden, you have Raptor, U.S. Nationals, coming in second at a Pro Tour. Ocho consistently finishing high. It's been great.
Second at Nationals.
Yeah.
This year.
Well, he didn't look too happy about it in the photo.
No. The photo has him, but.
But I mean, that's been a great thing to see too. Is local players really, really taking it to the next level?
Yeah, and I mean, honestly, because of the website is where the team came from. I mean, regardless of the fact that the vast majority of our team does produce content for the website and all that, it was actually the website that put the circumstances into place that would lead to the team. Mm-hmm. I mean, without the website, I would probably not have moved back to the Bay when I did. And spent a lot of time in San Jose, where I got to know Josh a lot better. I mean, I've known Webb forever, but the addition of Josh and Matt Ness, who also is, as much as I'm loath to say this on camera, a valuable member of the team. again, as Sean said, despite not wearing pants.
it's funny. I remember a Wizards article that they did just about our store in the local area. And again, you're talking about, you know, like, to us, the three of us, talking about like Webb and him being a superb player, Josh being a superb player. It seems like second nature to talk about. But not that long ago, you know, the Magic playing community and the greater whole didn't know these things. Mm-hmm. And our owner, John, like, the called shot with Matt Nass for GP Oakland, where it was like, you know, this is your store. Who are the people that are playing here? Like, who do you think is going to win? And he's like, oh, you know, Matt Nass. He's in the zone. And now look at him.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, you know, I guess the team, if you want to call it that, just it first started when it was just, like, me, Webb, Josh, you know, Matt, just kind of, like, playing locally and just getting together, testing for events, and it grew from there. And, you know, from there on, we've added a number of, you know, very good players, and that circle is, you know, broadened. Like, Paula was, you know, one of the people I knew really well, and after, you know, spending a lot of time together and hanging out, eventually he also joined, you know, and started writing for the site, and his articles are still, I think, my favorite. I still think he's the best writer.
Paula might be the best. So many things. He actually did an interview for Anthony, for the professors on our website, mm-hmm. recently, and they were asking just the differences between, you know, playing at a pro tour versus playing at a PTQ, and Paulo's answer was far and away the best.
What did he say?
Paulo was talking about, he's like, you know, when I play at a pro tour, and someone does something that's very seems confusing, or seems like, why would they take that line of play? Like, you're trying to follow them with it and be like, it has to have a reason, it has to have a purpose. And when you see someone do that at a PTQ level, you're not sure if they're doing it on purpose or not, or if it was a play mistake, or what's going on. He's like, it's so much harder to play to PTQ because it's harder to follow people's reasoning. And it just reminds me of Paulo's draft videos. Every time Paulo's trying to not only critique his own play, but try to understand a board state, and that's where really comes from. Yeah. Paulo, like, you know, it's kind of like when someone does something and he's like,
disbelief.
And to me, like, that possibly my favorite thing about the Channel Fireball experience was, without the website, without the draft videos that you were grandfathered, with all these things, I would have never gotten to a point where I could be inside Paulo's head, watching him play, and understand that.
Sharing his disbelief.
Really? Like, I don't know why he played this card. That exact thing.
Listening to Paulo's tones of shock disbelief when he's trying to explain one of his opponent's, like, really bad plays is, like, especially the best or the bad plays that end up beating you. Like, because those do exist. You know, they make a play that gives them one out instead of 15, but then they hit the one where it wouldn't have won them if they made the right play. And the indignance in his voice.
I know. And the best part is, it's like he doesn't play it up for the crowd. Like, this isn't like him
hamming it up. No, this is him.
This situation happened. We were in Philadelphia. We went to dinner, and he responds the same way about fondue. Like, he'd never had fondue. Like, they're gonna bring us more fondue. Really? They bring us more potatoes? Really? Like, this is really how you sound? This is this is incredible. But I can't believe I'm here for this. But not to be too self-serving. I mean, we're not just here to talk about how great Team Fireball is. I want to relate
it. But they're great.
I'm going to relate it I've heard. Immediately. I don't want to butcher names. How do you say Osip's last name?
Osip
Lebedowitz.
There we go.
Thank you. He did an interview recently where he mentioned Team Fireball, mentioned kind of their dominance, and how right now there's no one really competing against them as a group of players, like, not on a national team level, not on a website team level, not even like on a just group of guys that work together level. Do you think, not only is the group you're working with now the collection of the best players in the world, but do you look at any other groups as kind of your competition or who you look to play against right now when you go to these events?
I think he's a little off base in that there is actually another team, Team Mythic, which, mm-hmm. you know, is V's team, the New York, you know, group, whatever you want to call them, with, like, Finkel's V, Tom Martell, Zame joined them last time, Sam Black, Much like our team at the last Pro Tour, they were divided among decks, and they came out with two different decks. Some of them played, like, the blue-red, like, Swath type deck, and some played Infect, which Sam got, you know, third with at the Pro Tour. And Mythic is one of the few other actual organized teams, and they're consistently come with, you know, good decks. Like, sometimes I think our decks are better. In this Pro Tour, I actually think Infect might have been a better choice going in than Zoo. Though, I mean, our records are really good, and we weren't too far off, but given that what the metagame ended up looking like, their deck was quite good too. That being said, we made Cobblade. I mean, it's kind of hard to argue. Like, Cobblade, you know.
But it's always, it's more about what have you done today, though. I mean, not that, no, I mean, Zoo's there, and
February's
and
not
Zoo made
that
it,
long ago.
Well,
it's, you know, and the whole notion of, you know, do you have the best players on Team Fireball? You know, when there is Mythic out there with players like Finkel and Zvi, who admittedly are more old school, they're great players. And It's great. It's great. You know, being on Team Fireball, being part of Channel Fireball, you want to say something like, "Hey, these are the best players," and to a great degree, they are the best players today. But it's also a matter of cohesion. That's the thing about it. It's the team aspect. It's the cohesive aspect. And does that exist among other groups? And I think Mythic probably is really the only other one that's big and out there.
They're the only other group of players who I can point to as being a team.
Sure.
Like, regardless of
if certain people just playtest together.
Right? Yeah.
Or
like,
share information.
I mean, they even have a team name. Like, and honestly, like, people might think that team names are stupid or that sort of thing. It isn't, though. Having an identity is important. And the fact of the matter is, we're not just a lot of good players, even though we are a lot of good players, but we work together. I think that's actually the most important part. Because, yeah, you have people like Shouta Yasuka. He's, I think, one of the best technical players just, like, at all right now. And he comes with these insanely crazy decks, but I have to think if he had a good organized team, his decks would be better. And, you know, being good just isn't enough. Being good in a vacuum just doesn't help you crush a Pro Tour. And I think part of the reason we've been doing so well, and we've had, you know, I think pretty phenomenal results over the last, you know, year, year and a half, whatever, is because we not only have people who are very good, but we also actually work together quite well. I really like our team dynamic. And, you know, I trust that our team, given the proper time, which we tend to set aside, will get to the root of the format and come out with, the best deck.
That being said, I mean, since you guys have been dedicating the week beforehand, getting out there, really hitting the bricks and hitting it, what have been the metagame misses you've had? Like, where have things popped up that you're like, wow, that totally slipped through the cracks, we didn't see that?
Let's just take a look at, since I guess our first formation, let's just say this year, because that's probably the easiest. Mm-hmm. Even though in Chiba we did have blue, black, and five color, and we did quite well with both. But this year we had Cobblade in Paris, which I mean, no one can point to and say that this wasn't the best deck, not only of that tournament, of standard.
Of standard at that time, no question.
Yeah,
yes, Cobblade is certainly the best deck we've ever made, but it's also partly because it's the best deck in the last, 5 years. Mm-hmm. Led to a bunch of bannings, dominated the format. And that wasn't, I mean, other teams had it too. Like, the Japanese had various Stoneforge decks. There are other people in the tournament playing Stoneforge decks. So part of the reason I think that we get, you know, the credit for it is because we had a lot of good players playing it. So we not only had a good deck, we had a lot of good players.
Mm-hmm. I think that's going to push you over the top in a lot of circumstances that you're going to be able to bring up, where it's like your group of players is going to make the last kind of few tweaks. I mean, you're going to talk about it, so go ahead.
Nagoya.
Yeah.
Right. And see, here, it was walking in, my joke was that, like Paris, we have the best deck in the tournament. Unlike Paris, so does 30% of the field. So Nagoya, I actually don't think it was a miss. I think the format just as it was, you know, there wasn't anything ridiculously broken to find. The only other deck that I really liked out of that tournament was the Pure Steel deck that the Floridians played, like Pat Cox and David Sharpman, and that Heezy made. Mm-hmm. And that deck was good, and I think I would have considered playing it. But I think White Weenie was still just the best deck. We tested extensively for the format, and we came up with what we thought was the best version of the best deck, and I was happy with it. I mean, I didn't lose any matches. So.
I think that's what pushes you guys over the top, because you're talking about getting a dozen guys together in a room that are that diverse group of thinkers. I mean, the example that I thought you were going to touch on, but you know, I get it, is Connolly Woods coming in there with the mutagenic growths in your mono white deck.
Well, yeah. I mean, that was just part of the whole. But
I'm saying, like, let's say another group of players or another player knows that Tempered Steel or some White Weenie variant is the best deck to play at this Pro Tour. We figured it out from our testing. I figured it out from playing it online, et cetera, et cetera. But I don't know necessarily, like, I haven't played 50 games where I decided to play a card like Mutagenic Growth in my sideboard, where you guys have that.
Yeah, and it gave us a very big edge against Mono Red, which we expected to be probably like the second most popular deck, and I think it was. I don't know the exact numbers, but, and the reason was because it saved Hero Bladehold from Dismember, Galvanic Blast, Red Sun Zenith, all those cards. So,
how much of that process, though, because you have so many players together working in Team Fireball, is about, you know, crafting the best deck based on predicting the metagame? Because you get to play so many matches, you get to play so many variants.
I mean, there's a lot that goes into it. And honestly, like, the deck I spent most of my time working on it was Blue-White Control. And it ended up not being good enough, but I was able to recognize that and walk away from it. But if Blue-White Control had been good, I think we would have had a good version of it. And that's kind of what the team does, is we work on different things. We're not all working on the same deck until we've decided this is the deck. Mm-hmm. So all the lead-in is people championing different decks. And that's the way to do it, because that way, if one of these decks is the deck, we'll have work done on it, and we can then focus. And the most important part comes once we've chosen the deck, and hopefully the earlier the better, but you get a lot of new information late, so you can't usually do that. And then everyone just jams with that deck and does the best. And that's why, moving on to Philadelphia, we had differences in opinion. There's no far and away best deck. I'm happy with Zoo. I'm glad I played it. I didn't decide on playing it till the day before. Conley and Matt Nass still played Pyromancer Swath. Lucas Blohan played the Malira deck that him and some of the other Czechs played and ended up doing well with. Martin played Green-Black Infect. Like, there were differences of opinion. But at the end of the day, the vast majority of us played Zoo, which this is, had been Kibler's pet the entire time, and it turned out to be the deck we wanted to play. So having Kibler work on it while we worked on, Webb was working on Cloud Post, me and Matt were working on Swath, everyone was working on all the decks to some extent, but we had people more invested in certain decks, and if one of those decks had been good, we would have had a good version of it. They weren't, but we still had a good version to test against. And so far, I've been happy with our preparation. We had the Infect deck. We decided that we did not like the Zoo matchup, so we kind of left it, whereas the Team Mythic kept working on it, and they found some things that made it better, like Peer through depths into Dragonstorm, Spellskite.
Snapback.
Snapback is, that's not that hard to find, and it's just like Slaughter Pack. That wasn't as big of a deal.
Peer had to be the key, though.
Peer was something we didn't try because after testing the deck for a day, we decided we just wanted to move on. But it was still good. The deck was good, and the way the format ended up being, they had a lot of favorable matchups. I think I'm very happy with how our team has done this year, and I anticipate Worlds going well, too.
So now, when you go into an event, you guys are obviously very confident. You're very collected as far as, making sure you stay on task, kind of, and eventually get there.
Well, we have the OSHA to play the role of enforcer.
Yes, exactly. It's true. Webb is very
lights
good
out.
At,
lights out means lights out.
Finding dinner, all these things. Yeah. I don't want this to come off the wrong way. When you end up at an event weekend, especially the day before a Pro Tour, or when you first get to a site and you start seeing all those other players, are you guys actually afraid of missing something? Afraid of another group of players? What? Even just interested, let's try to scout this other group? Because even standing around the table of the team, Friday morning in Philadelphia, every single person, it's funny, these guys sit down at the first table that's entered the player area. They're not in the back of the room, not covering their deck lists really well.
Well, we need to sit near the dealers in case we needed last minute cards, which we did.
Yeah, but every single, because I'm just, I'm perched watching the people around, these guys. Every single person is just trying to see what's on that deck list, watch everybody
try
to
fan
their...
Yeah, we had to chastise people to, flip their deck list over.
And it was Owen sitting there next to Josh being okay, well, what do I want this with at this time? And I'm just everyone is burdened, these guys. So obviously a lot of other players in the room, not to say they're afraid of Team Fireball or they're intimidated, but they want to know. They want to know what you guys are up to. So, and then to go back the night before, or even that morning, even morning of the Pro Tour, we're walking down the street and you guys are gathering information from, this guy knows that these guys are playing this deck, and does that mean that we want to play this card? Does that come back a couple days I'm worried about this group of people?
It's not like there's a group of people where oh man, what are, the Japanese playing? What are Team Mythic playing? Exactly. It's more like, there's this information dance, and Paula talked about it in his report, how at Grand Prix Pittsburgh, it's a little farther out. People were you talk to a lot of people trying to figure out what they know, and they're trying to figure out what you know. And because an exchange of information generally helps both parties, but you don't want to give away too much. Luckily for us in Pittsburgh, we couldn't give away anything because we didn't really know what we were going to play. So, we were protected. We were insulated.
Oh, yeah, great. Ignorance, huh?
Ignorance is bliss. But
it's been your friend for ages.
Yes, it has. See, Mashi, I've known you for a while. But I think as the closer to you get to an event, the more information you get just naturally. Our team did pretty good on people not knowing we were playing. In round four, Martel got an email from one of his friends who was following coverage, who had scouted people's deck lists and was emailing him a list of all the people playing. And they had me on Splinter Twin with Noble Hierarch Acceleration. That was the deck that they had.
Sweet. Yeah, sweet.
So we did a good job this time of keeping it under wraps what we were playing. And I think that's because our guys are taking it more seriously. You don't want people to get the benefit of your work for free. In Paris, we were a little sloppy, and there were other people in the tournament playing Stoneforge because we were. That shouldn't have been. We shouldn't have given them that information. But you know, we worked on it, and I think we're doing a lot better. In Nagoya, there was nothing to steal because everyone had White Weenie.
So if you're at a Pro Tour or any major event in the future and you see these guys just sitting with their cards face up, you know that there's no hidden information.
Well,
playing the best deck that everyone knows about.
We do it. We try to. Like I said, we were chastising people who had their deck lists up and their sideboards fanned out. That's not what we wanted. And we did a pretty good job because, again, hidden information is powerful. And the fact that our team was split a little bit, there were a couple of people not playing the deck, helped to conceal it too, because one disadvantage of being in a large team is, I mean, someone plays against Paul, then they play against me, they can put me on the same deck. But Sam played against Martin, and then played against Paulo, and thought they were on the same deck when they were on opposite decks.
I definitely, being on the rails for this event, it was hilarious. Mm-hmm. And again, in that morning of that first table, Connolly's sitting on the end there, and Connolly and Matt Ness, the only ones playing the same deck. So he's sitting there watching everyone else come by and scope you guys out, and watching, you know, like Owen just fanning his sideboard, and he's not saying anything. But as soon as Matt Ness like goes back to like check his list, so like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
What are you doing? Like, you know,
it's to Connolly's benefit. That was an advantage Connolly had. Everyone thought he was going to be playing Zoo if they had seen the rest of our team. And then he would, you know, go Steam Vince Bright of Flame. So I think, yeah, I mean, secrecy is important, but so is, like, you don't want to cut yourself off. Like, especially if you're, like, I mean, you don't want to be too strict about it. Like, it's not like that. This isn't like, you know, a top secret weapons program. Like, having a little flexibility helps, again, you and the person you're talking to. Like, just getting people's general thoughts on the format. You can do that without giving anything too important up, while still, you know, being cordial and, you know, not being like a jerk about it. Like,
well, that brings up the other side of having a team, is not everyone's on the team.
Yeah.
And figuring out, you know, who you're testing with, who you're not testing with, you know. It's like the worst breakup ever, that email, we won't be testing with you.
Okay, first of all, we don't email people.
That's right. They open their locker and there's a black ball in there. You're off the team.
I heard rumors of a form email being sent out for Team Mythic.
That was awesome.
Sorry, fill in the blank.
Yeah. It's like, we didn't even tell you in person.
Yeah.
It's not quite the text breakup, it's the email breakup. Yeah, Thank you very much.
I mean, that aside, people can run their teams however they want to. And yeah, I mean, if I teamed with every person I was friends with, our team would be too big.
One or two, yeah.
Yeah. So
just Luis and Ocho at the table all day.
I don't think Webb would be there. Nah. It'd be Luis and Humphrey.
Right. You're so mean.
Yeah. But yeah, like that's part of picking and choosing is not fun, but we've got it. We've had basically the same team we've had since Chiba pretty much,
yeah.
And we haven't really looked to do a whole lot of addition or subtraction. So
that goes right into the next question. I mean, here you are looking forward. You know, we know what Team Fireball today is. We've seen the successes. At this point, you know, there's fear, there's expectation. You're expecting to see one of those shirts.
I'm sure people would love us to do poorly, but you know,
humble.
Despite your best efforts.
Hey, I mean, we like I said, I feel comfortable in the fact that we have enough people that if we ever get to the point where, you know, just the train's going right off a cliff, one of the people will grab control and save it. Mm-hmm. And like, for example, this time, you know, Kilber was like, "Hey guys, you know, you really need to play this." And at the end, we ended up listening to him despite, you know, weeks of, you know, haha, wild Mikado jokes aside, you know, that's what we played. And it ended up being fine. It ended up being good. I really like the deck. So yeah, I'm happy with the team, and you're asking.
No, so you guys are like about a dozen members strong today, you'd say.
Something like that, yeah.
Something like that. You gotta know where to button down the hatches, like who's involved, who's not involved. Do you see you're working with the same group of people at the same kind of level for not only Worlds this year, but events going into 2012?
I can't speak to next year because that's just too far ahead. I mean, we don't know what everyone's plans will look like. We don't know what everyone's, you know, pro level will be and what tournaments they'll be going to.
Is that the email list? Sorry, your pro level's dropped too far.
No.
You are not a high enough level Archmage to be part of our
That's not how it is, but, you know, people will, their commitment to Magic, you know, may wax and wane as is appropriate. Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. I'm not saying that you should just do this. And if someone decides they want to do something else, they're more than welcome to do so.
Trust me. Ben Stark spent a lot of time Friday night after not making day two about how this was mostly for fun and how he loses money anytime he comes to play a Pro Tour. So
well, Ben,
you better want to do it.
Yeah, Ben's an interesting case. But in any case, going into Worlds, it looks like we're pretty much the same roster. We've got some plans to have everyone come out. I mean, Worlds is 10 minutes from where I live.
It's in our backyard. I mean, it's really right in Channel Fireball home turf.
Which I'm really looking forward to. I think
we're actually working on converting the warehouse into just cots.
Yeah, exactly.
Or double wides, depending on who's going to actually make the trip out.
But. Yeah, so no, I've already got a list of like the where I'm going to take people to eat and, you know, where we're going to test and all that stuff. And yeah, it should be fun. We should have a good time, I think. It's going to be very relaxing to have it at home. Though that also adds a little more complication. When I'm away, you know, I can just be away from it all and not have to worry about stuff. But when I'm at home, I still have my, you know, home responsibilities to take care of. So.
There's also that stress that you're talking about. And I remember during GP Oakland having this of like trying to facilitate, make sure, because so many other people host you when you're over there. Now you're the host.
Yeah, you're
you have
the one
to play
in charge.
That role. You have to make sure they do get some flavor of San Francisco and everything while they're here because they take care of you when you're traveling abroad. That's just part of being a part of the larger Magic
I've never
community.
Stayed at PV's house, so.
Well, I wouldn't recommend it.
I mean, I saw Fast and Furious 5. Brazil's a dangerous place.
So, but I mean, and that was, I mean, I remember running out to Zachary's and doing stuff like that. Just because,
Zachary's is one of the places we're going.
Yeah. Always.
Best pizza
that's an
ever
LSV
had.
Required spot,
exactly.
Zachary's.
But F-Fub might be in the works too, we'll see. But yeah, I mean, I think looking up to Worlds, I would be disappointed if we didn't have, you know, sweet decks for Worlds. Especially day three of Worlds is, I've said this many times, the most exploitable format always, because no one ever tests for it. They always just like, hey, if I'm doing well, I'll just throw something together, and we try to test for it. And, you know, my day three record at Worlds the last 3 years is, you know, I think I had like one.
You're averaging like 5-1?
Yeah.
A little better than that, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, there was one point in extended between like GPLA, Worlds, you know, where you were undefeated in the format.
Well, one of those involved me playing Swans at Worlds 08, where I went 6-0. I'm not going to take full credit for that one. If you look up that deck list, I may have run a little good. So, but yeah, Worlds is one of my favorite tournament, despite it, you know, I've never had a top 8 at Worlds, and it's still my favorite tournament. So I'm really looking forward to it, and if one of us doesn't win it, I'll be a little disappointed. But yeah, I have high hopes.
Good to know.
So yeah, I guess that's a good.
Well, I think that's one of the ways that Team Fireball has affected its own players, you and everyone else, is it, doing so well starts to raise that bar for expectations, not just for people watching the team, but for members of the team,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, for sure.
And that's not just being cocky. There's just a sense of, like, past results lending confidence to future results. And that's important, too. I mean, being confident in the deck you have and in you know, the drafts you've had and your preparation is huge.
It's not that, like, I go in expecting to win every tournament. It's that I go in hoping to and knowing that we put ourselves in the position to do it.
Well, in all fairness, no one here goes into tournaments expecting you to win them. So,
that's true.
You know.
So, yeah, that's a nice look at the team, the website, the show with our, was it like an 80-20 ratio of TSG to Tamashii over there?
Almost exactly. Yeah,
that's okay. We're coming back. I mean, here we've been sitting here for half an hour and we're coming back to 1-1 a lot closer now.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Mm-hmm.
No, hopefully not too self-serving. That was awkward at points. Luis wins a lot, and he then gets other people that win a lot to come hang out with him. It's what I've learned from sitting here.
Well, in all fairness, Luis has to win, otherwise people wouldn't hang out with him.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, that's very self-serving.
There's the Mashi we were looking forward to.
And then every once in a while he pays for lunch. It all works out.
I did pay for lunch today, so I'm very happy.
Out of the kindness of his heart. He's like, you guys are coming out here. It's going to be a long day. We got a lot of stuff to film. Drag Mashi all the way from L.A. I'll buy lunch, guys. That's how Luis
That's
is.
Kind of how it happened, except that involved me losing a
multiple
coin flip to
coin
TSG.
Flips, yeah.
But
one historic thing, I think, with Channel Fireball that is important, and maybe this is more from my aspect of it, my view of the website, how the website came about, is really the rise of the Magic video. More than the super team than Team Fireball, the whole idea of the Magic video of like, watch a pro get inside their head, which we talked about with Paulo, but how that's changed how Magic strategy and Magic content has hit the internet. I mean, it's huge. It's almost the standard now where, you know, it started off with, you know, being in John's garage with Alex Alapin and having two guys who are very good at draft watch me, who's very bad at draft, right, rolling their eyes, sighing, going, why are you picking this? Why are you doing that? And thinking, you know, there ought to be a video out there for people who are bad at drafting. And seeing where it's at today, where it's like, you know, I go to Channel Fireball and I'm like, wait, there's no new video today? What's going on? Like, I need a new video every day to watch.
Yeah, and as far as I know, like, when I started with Shards of Alara, just drafting that and doing videos of that, and that was the first time I did draft videos. And yeah, I think in a lot of ways that did popularize, you know, the rise of the Magic draft video. Mm-hmm. I mean, Constructed too, but draft is really
humble all of a sudden. I mean, Anytime. I remember when we were getting just Brad starting to do them and trying to work with him about, and you, like, talking to Matt Ness, like, overhearing conversation, like, as we expanded the circle of people who were doing it, it was kind of like, you know, Luis is really the grandfather of this. Like, go back, watch what he said, watch, like, how he kept the conversation with himself going, how he made himself laugh, like...
How he kept the one-landers.
Yeah, like... how he had the cats.
And then, you know, like, adding Connolly into the mix, where it's like, you know, even if you're not going to win this thing, even if you don't, like, if you're drafting M10 number 16...
Even if your Glenn Hawk idol gets crushed. Yeah.
this is what you don't realize out there. Luis has forced Connolly to make videos to be a foil for his own videos. So,
exactly.
I mean, let's let the cat out of the bag. That's why we have Connolly on.
Yeah. We're not out of the woods yet.
But and again, every day you might get puns like that within your own draft videos or the legendary Lorthos draft.
Yeah. Still my favorite draft. The last ZZW draft I did.
And we'll ever do.
No. I actually recorded one recently as a throwback. But
wow.
But it's
you
not.
You broke it?
Like, yeah, it doesn't
how
top.
Can you, again, you can't.
The Lorthos is still the best one where in this hyper aggressive Zendikar format, I won every match with, you know, Lorthos the Tidemaker.
Quite handily.
Quite handily, yeah.
But, I mean...
did such things as keep five lands, like, Battle Herda, Iona's Judgment, and... You know,
and got there.
Yeah, just easily win.
And we also like these things, is what you've learned. Yeah. We're sitting here talking about it, like, it's the greatest
thing ever. I've watched that video many times. I actually enjoy watching it.
It really did
that
kind of...
it
lifted the veil for all of us to realize that Luis Scott Vargas truly is... a huge luck sack. I mean, a huge luck sack.
Chantalar was the best place to start because you're like, oh, I need four colors of mana. My hand has four.
Well, I remember snapping off Crumbling Necropolis, Executioner's Capsule, five other spells on the play,
right.
Rolling two lands right off the top and just easily winning.
I mean, like, that's been one of the best parts of the ride.
Look, it's my gift to the community. do as I say, not as I do.
Yeah, don't remember, this is a trained professional. Please don't try to duplicate this at home. We got to put those on the LSV draft videos.
Yeah.
So I just had to get that in. That's one of the things that, looking at Channel Fireball from when we started to where we're at now, that it's one of the most impressive things for me, especially now being more in the back seat and going to the website more as to watch the content, to see what's going on. It blows me away how the excitement that we had starting it and now just going there and saying, God, the video player sucks. I don't care if it's free. Where's my new draft video? You know what I mean? So that to me is what I think about when I reflect back on Channel Fireball.
Yeah. I think looking at the team, looking at the website, I think all of it, I think the videos is like probably the biggest contribution that we've made just to the Magic scene as a whole. And you know, I think I like that.
No one can argue that you didn't set a standard that now other people have to follow and would be so hard to leapfrog it and create something better. I mean, and that's speaking to every aspect of it. Again, like, you doing the commentary for these drafts, still the best. I mean, as much as I love Paulo and what he says on camera, like, Luis is the person that you would, if anyone, any new writer, anyone come to the website and like, now we're gonna have him do videos, like, go watch Luis's stuff.
God, I feel terrible. I watch yours on mute.
And you can't understand the plays. They're just inexplicable.
What does he do? Is that a misclick? That's another misclick.
That's the new series I want to get. I want the Ben Stark watching the muted drafts of other people on the website.
That might be a good plan.
Yeah, that would be great.
But yeah, this was...
We should really run with that idea now before we lose it. Yeah.
So I'm feeling like it's time for some top eights.
Okay, let's hit them. Now that we've exhausted our retrospective...
Maybe I should regrow out the mustache again.
That would be pretty sweet.
Just without the goatee.
Yeah.
Where do we want to start?
Look at Sean, he combed his hair.
Wait. How do I look? Don't worry, it's a rhetorical question. I know I look good.
The sunlight's coming. I got a Kesha concert to go to. Let's get things done.
Are you going to that too?
Kesha?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Oh, jeez.
Eric's going to that.
Hey, quiet on the set, guys. We've got a Kesha concert. Come on, guys. We got a deadline.
What did you brush your teeth with today?
Yeah, with Jack.
Sean doesn't brush his teeth.
Oh, trick question.
I've never felt more uncomfortable sitting right here.
All right, we are live in 3, 2.
Can you put money in my meter?
Yeah, and the one to the right of it. You put one quarter in both of them, and then when I leave, I'll put another quarter in yours.
Two more, that's a deal. No.
It's like far fewer people are like, what's that dumb white card sitting in the tree? But everyone's gonna be like, is that a Black Lotus? Is that a Black Lotus? Why is there a Black Lotus in the tree? These guys are just throwing cards away. Oh shit, the light's on.
Yeah, Sean. Come on, you only have to water it once every 6 months. You can at least fill up the water globe.
Says the guy who doesn't look at the spoiler at his feet to see the cards.
Well, he's got the thing open right there.
Tiny, right. Tiny, tiny.
Just gave me my outtakes, thanks, man. Did you read that one comment? Did someone forget to water Sean?
Yeah. That's good. No, I just explained that he got up too late. He slept in.
Jackasses.
What else?
Wait till the ladder's up or whatever.
That looks pretty dangerous.
And that's why we aren't doing it.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
Fat guys and ladders.
Why isn't that a website?
What's wrong
Three.
With you?
Instead of mashing them together.
Ladies and gentlemen, web scratch.
Can we get it all on?
I really hope you got that.
And no one cared about the cost of lands. Not a single person. Every single comment was like, why are we talking about this?
Wait, that one you did about the cost of land was actually about the
yes.
basic lands? They weren't. I thought you guys were talking about like
you know something interesting.
What no. rare lands cost. Like, no. That the Zendikar lands went up.
Yeah.
You guys all laugh. Like,
oh man, those glasses give me a headache.
Almost 15 minutes.
Pretty good.
That's what she said. No hockey jersey?
I had work to do today.
Jeez. Wow.
I know.
People are going to talk about that.
That's fine. Yeah. This is what we get.
We're in the playoffs.
I know.
Playoffs?
I got work to do.
I'm a busy man.
You make sure your phone is not going to emit very weird noises like it always does.
It's off. Not. Are we really just 20 minutes of joke top 8 lists today?
No, we could do a sweet topic.
Are you one of
the what about the grooming regimen you use for your eyebrows?
Oh, naturel, my friend. No enhancement.
Those babes are...
I know you're digging deep. You're trying hard. Can't get enough.
TSG's played that card quite a bit, actually.
It's been played on me a lot.
Yeah. It's one of his favorite cards.
He's when I go to a bar and I give a woman my number. Right on the back of one of these bad boys.
It's his business card.
Quiet on the set, please.
I just want to open a bar now.
Boom. You got one more?
No, I think that's it.
One more?
Definitely. Commander cards, right? Everyone wants to know about commander cards.
Let's talk about all the playable commander cards. Oh, okay, we did that. Just TSG.
That's TSG.
Or just like a slide of his laugh. Like the different frames.
Sad thing is when this dies, who knows what the next thing will be.
Yeah, it could be worse. You're better off sticking with this.
Great.
You know the enemy.
The yeah. bar could only go lower.
Yes. It only goes one way.
So we're starting with the top A list. Not doing it.
All right. Go on, TST, just once.
Just once?
Yeah.
It's actually created in post. That's what makes it special.
Okay, just laugh a little bit.
You can't make me do that?
No, seriously, come on, do a
Anyway.
I'll make this episode disappear.
Hey everyone, welcome to another MTV. Here not with us is Mashi. Instead we have Tristan Sean Gregson here.
Nice to see everybody.
Still Humphrey, a little worse for wear now that Mashi moved away and hasn't been watering him, which I believe actually is one of your duties now too.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes. I really hope he likes coffee. Maybe
anyway.
A little Red Bull. We'll see how it works out.
So, But anyway, thanks and welcome, Sean, to the new show.
Hey, I'm looking forward to being back more than once.
All right, well, we'll see about that.
Oh, thanks.
See if Humphrey survives. It's up to him.
I love you, big guy.
Thanks for watching.